So here we move to parvovirus. What do you know about parvovirus? What all things do you remember? So we know that it is a single-stranded DNA virus, non-enveloped, smallest, then linear DNA, and replicates in the nucleus, and so on and so forth. So measures around 18 to 26 nanometer. Parvovirus B19, yes. This belongs to the genus Erythrovirus. There are total three genera, out of which, even if you remember two, it's okay. One is Dependovirus, which is along with the Adenovirus. Mm. And this Erythrovirus, which has Parvovirus B19, which is most significant in case of human infections. This causes exclusive human infection. It can be infection can be transmitted either by the respiratory secretions or via blood transfusion, or it's possible that it will be transmitted transplacentally. The erythroid progenitor cells, they have a blood group P antigen, okay, P for parvovirus. This is the receptor for adhesion of parvovirus. And then the parvovirus gets inserted inside the progenitor cell itself before it goes into complete RBC formation. And hence, it leads to premature RBC destruction. And there is also erythropoiesis inhibition. And that's why the genus is also known as Erythrovirus. Very important pathogenicity here is called as fifth disease, also known as erythema infectiosum. Here, a child comes with a slack cheek appearance. There is erythematous rash on both the cheek. This happens in case of pediatric age group. If parvovirus causes infection in the adult, then it leads to symmetrical polyarthropathy. Okay, so the joints are involved. The skin rash is not so predominant. And do you have any idea what is the first disease, second disease, and so on? The diseases which come in the chronological order. Take this down, it might help you somewhere. The first disease is measles. A second one is scarlet fever. That's caused by Streptococcus pyogenes group A. The third disease is rubella. The fourth disease was known as Duke's disease. The fifth disease is this parvovirus B19, erythema infectiosum. And the sixth disease is roseola infantum, that is caused by human herpes viridis 6. Also called as Exanthema subitum. Now, this sequence has no chronological relation with the baby. For example, if you see exanthematous diseases, then the baby is first likely to get measles, followed by scarlet fever, followed by rubella. There is nothing like that. All right. Now, the other presentations could be transient aplastic crisis, especially where patient had some hemolytic anemia and superadded, he gets the parvovirus infection. So for some time, the bone marrow stops synthesizing RBCs and there is severe anemia, or the patient presents with maybe hemoglobin less than 5 or something like that. Then there is pure red cell aplasia. This generally occurs, or it leads it to chronic anemia. Many a time, the patient is immunocompromised and may reflect or may occur in adults. And then there can be transplacental transmission of parvovirus, which will lead to non-immune Hydrops fetalis. The risk is more in second trimester. Okay, so we saw slap cheek appearance in case of erythema infectiosum. That's in babies. Then if it occurs in adults, then it is symmetrical arthropathy. And then RBC related, all the complications like transient aplastic anemia, chronic anemia because of pure red cell aplasia, and non-immune type Hydrops fetalis. Immune we always know, Rh negative and Rh positive incompatible blood groups. But this is non-immune type of hydroxyurea. Okay, so this is all about parvovirus. Now we move to the third non-enveloped virus, small in size. It lies in between parvo and adeno, that is papilloma virus. It has got circular DNA. So double-stranded DNA around 50 nanometer in size. There are many viruses in papilloma viridae family. We just know human papilloma virus, but it has another genus called as polyoma. Okay, so the family is papova viridae. It has genus papilloma virus and polyoma virus. And in polyoma virus, there are different strains. One is BK. BK virus causes nephropathy in transplant patients. Then there is Jesse. Jesse virus leads to progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy. Then SV40 is an interesting virus. It does not lead to any human infections. And this is used as challenge virus for interference test. When we are growing some virus which does not produce any cytopathic effect, then we challenge the cell line with SV40 because it leads to vacuolations in the cell line. And then there is Merkel virus. Merkel is associated with Merkel cell CA. Merkel is also a virus which is a high inducer of interferon. Okay? So remember BK, JC, SV40, Merkel and HPV. These are all DNA viruses. So if at all you get a question, which of the following is not a DNA virus? You must remember that these also belong, like CMV, EBV, variola vaccinia, molluscum contagiosum. These are all DNA viruses. Okay. Now what does papilloma virus leads to? It leads to warts, common warts or plantar warts where they are present. Sometimes flat warts depending upon the morphology of the warts. And one particular important clinical condition is condyloma acuminata. These are enogenital warts. Okay. Another term you can get confused with is condyloma lata or condylomata. What is that? Secondary syphilis, where there is bacillemia. Spirochetes are present, traveling all over the organs through blood vessels, right? And this is condyloma acuminata. These are enogenital warts due to HPV. Now in cervix and larynx, in both the sides, it will lead to benign lesion like cervical intraepithelial neoplasia, as commonly it is known. And both the benign lesions are caused by strain number 6 and 11. Okay, remember, because this is also asked many a times. And when it comes to CA cervix or CA larynx, laryngeocarcinoma, then 16 and 18 are the strains which lead to cancerous, invasive type of cancerous lesion. For CA cervix, there are other strains also, like 30, 31, 33, 45. But they are not so common. 16 and 18 is common for both cervix and larynx. Okay. Small talk about HPV vaccine. This is best if it is given to the young females or young adolescent female before the first sexual intercourse. Because even during the first sexual intercourse, if the barrier methods are not followed, there is likelihood that the woman will be exposed to HPV. And before first exposure, if the vaccine is given, then it is said that it has a very good efficacy. There are two vaccines available. One is Gardasil, which is quadrivalent, which includes the strains which cause benign neoplastic lesion also, like CIN. The strains are 6, 11 for benign and 16, 18 for the cancerous origin. And there is bivalent vaccine available, known as Cervarix, which covers only the malignant type of strains, that is 16 and 18. Here we complete the revision for these viruses.